Recorded Books presents Loving's Love, A Black American's Experience in Aviation by Neal V. Loving, narrated by James Shippy. Prologue. Hastening to Disaster. Sunday morning, July 30th, 1944. I was scheduled to hold a training session for selected Civil Air Patrol, CAP, cadets at Wings Airport outside Detroit, to ensure that my glider, Wayne S1, NX27775, was airworthy. I went to my glider manufacturing facility, Wayne Aircraft Company, co-owned by longtime friend Ursley Taylor, the day before to complete the pre-flight inspection. Upon finding a loose seat bracket, I began the necessary repairs, but was not able to finish before it became necessary to leave for the 3 p.m. shift at the Ford Motor Company. When I called Ursley, without hesitation, she promised her brother Rudy would be able to complete the repairs that day. With that assurance, I went to work in pleasant anticipation of a date the next day with my fiancée, Marie Patterson. The spring and summer had been unseasonably cool, and this was our first opportunity for an outdoor activity. We had planned a picnic just for the two of us at Belle Isle after my morning CAP duties were completed. We looked forward to being together in the quiet, wooded picnic area, enjoying our lunch and watching the huge iron ore freighters move down the Detroit River. Reporting for work on a Saturday afternoon shift, I asked my supervisor for permission to take Sunday off, due to the war Ford was working 7 days a week, with the provision that if the weather was bad, I would cancel my plans and report for work as usual. However, Sunday turned out to be a beautiful summer day, which, in the course of events to follow, changed the shape of my life forever. After leaving Ford's at midnight, I drove straight to the shop to check on NX27775. The repairs had not been completed. Since it was too late to cancel the CAP training session, I worked furiously to repair the damaged seat structure. It was almost 5 a.m. when the job was completed, and my body and mind were fatigued. Arriving home, I took a quick bath and went to bed for 2 hours of sleep. At 8 a.m., I was back at the glider shop where the CAP cadets had been ordered to report. Ursley, our CAP commander, Rudy, and Marie were already there and joined the cadets in loading NX27775 onto the trailer. Since we had done this procedure many times, it was not long before we departed for Wings Airport, 18 miles north of Detroit. After turning into the airport driveway, I stopped at the office to ask the manager about conditions of the field, which was being graded and was in poor condition except for the one sod runway. He suggested I check on the field condition by driving my car out on the field. Looking at my watch, I knew this would delay my planned picnic, so I decided against it and walked directly to the fully assembled glider. My crew chief informed me that a critical portion of the glider tow rope had been inadvertently left at the shop, which would seriously reduce the altitude I could attain before completing my usual 180-degree turn and downwind landing. Again, ignoring proper safety procedures and precautions, I decided to proceed without delay. A glance at the windsock showed the wind was blowing across the runway, which would mean a loss of precious altitude while compensating for drift. Even with this disturbing news, there was no sense of alarm. Climbing into the cockpit, I checked the airspeed indicator, a chrome-plated circular wind vane mounted in front of me on a vertical streamlined post. The vane rotated against the calibrated spring as airspeed increased. Reading from 0 to 50 miles per hour were printed on the outer edge. It was properly set at 0 miles per hour. In my hurry, however, I failed to note that the calibrated spring was not also set at 0, resulting in the airspeed indicator registering 10 miles per hour higher than actual airspeed. This meant my normal indicated gliding speed would be dangerously close to stalling speed. But full of confidence and anxious to get this training mission completed, I ordered the tow rope hooked up. Ursley raised the left wing until NX27775 was level on its single wheel, and I signaled Rudy in the tow car to start the tow. The morning air was cool, and my yellow and blue creation, the S1, climbed like the proverbial homesick angel after takeoff. Soon the telltale aerodynamic burbles shaking the glider indicated that maximum attainable altitude had been reached. Pulling the tow rope release knob, I soared away in the smooth morning air, enjoying the special beauty of silent flight. This brief exhilaration ended as I entered a gentle 180-degree turn to the left in preparation for my final approach. The lowered wing blocked sight of the runway until a major portion of the turn had been completed. When the runway came into view, it was evident the crosswind had pushed me well to the right of the center line. This meant a loss of precious altitude during the extra turn required to line up with the runway. In my haste, I decided to land in the area adjacent to the runway, which I had neglected to inspect. Turning on final approach, I saw the graded area in front of me had a ridge of dirt piled about 2 feet high, making it dangerously unsuitable for landing. My airspeed indicator indicated a normal 35 miles per hour, which is actually only 25 miles per hour. So I increased my bank angle to get back to the runway. As the necessary control pressures were applied, the glider stalled and immediately entered a left tailspin. The earth whirled furiously around as I plunged almost vertically toward the ground. My gentle, obedient little glider had turned against me like a family pet suddenly gone wild. Even though it seemed sure I would crash into the spinning earth of brown and green, I tried desperately to recover. Pushing the stick forward, with ailerons, neutral, and full right rudder stopped the spin. But now the ground rushed up to meet me before the glider could level off. Diving into the ground, the nose of the glider collapsed into wood splinters, crushing both my feet while my head pitched forward against the metal instrument panel with tremendous force. In an instant, I was transformed from a young man happily looking forward to a fun-filled afternoon to one in a state of blinding, overwhelming pain, followed by brief oblivion. Prologue to a radically different, sometimes difficult, and always challenging new way of life. Chapter 1. Dreams. The pilot of a silver-winged de Havilland DH-4 biplane flying over the west side of Detroit on a summer day in 1926, will never know the lasting impact his passage of flight had on me, a 10-year-old boy. At that moment, I was engaged in a losing argument with my oldest brother, Bernard, Barney, regarding my right to build an outdoor radio antenna adjacent to his. He had already successfully built several radios from plans printed in a monthly radio magazine, and I was envious. The sounds and smells that emanated from his relatively crude, battery-powered radios were so fascinating, I wanted one of my own. Putting on a pair of earphones and listening to static-filled voices and music was magical indeed. However, to reach beyond the local stations, an outside antenna at least 75 to 100 feet in length was required. It was considered quite a feat in those early days to get what was called distance, that is, to pick up radio stations from such far-off places as WLW in Cincinnati, Ohio, or KDKA in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. Barney had already laid out long, shiny copper strands of antenna wire on the ground, ready to string it from our house to the garage, when he raised objections to my proposed antenna, arguing it would interfere with his radio reception. At that moment, the roar of the approaching airplane almost drowned out his words. As the low-flying biplane passed overhead, my attention was drawn to the sky and the apparent magic of flight. Barney's fellow radio enthusiast, Harold Madgett, looked up and stated with the sure confidence of a 14-year-old, "I know what kind of airplane that is. It's a DH-4 mail plane with a Liberty engine." Following Harold's gaze, I watched the silver and blue DH-4 until it disappeared into the haze-filled horizon of downtown Detroit. Noticing my curiosity, Barney seized the opportunity to suggest I change my interest from radio to aviation. In retrospect, my brother really did me a favor. His idea changed the direction of my life forever. But I am not sure I was appreciative at the time. The more I thought about aviation, the more exciting and attractive it became. I found my family's reaction, however, to be skeptical and derisive. My parents, Harden Clay loving and Alma loving, were pessimistic since they knew there were no opportunities for blacks in aviation. My father had firsthand experience with the difficulties of being a pioneer. In 1925, he was the first black to pass the Michigan State Board of Examiners in the practice of optometry. He studied at Columbia Optical College in St. Paul, Minnesota, and had graduated in 1924 while supporting a wife and four children with a full-time job as conductor on the South Shore Railroad operating from Duluth to St. Paul. In retrospect, I realized my father, a tall, fair-skinned man with gray eyes and dark wavy hair, must have been passing for white, as blacks were at that time restricted to more menial positions, such as Pullman porters. His Caucasian appearance confused a white real estate salesman who came into his office at 911 Gratiot Avenue to sell him a home in an exclusive area where blacks were barred by restrictive covenants. Father immediately called out, "Alma, come into the office, please." Mother came in, her brown face in pleasing contrast to her starched white office uniform. Looking the salesman straight in the eye, my father introduced her. "I want you to meet my wife, Mrs. Loving." Salvaging what dignity he could, the salesman beat a hasty retreat. Looking eagerly for someone to share my newfound interests, I tried to talk aviation with my brother Robert and sister Ardeen, but they wouldn't listen, much less partake in conversation. Despite the lack of support and skepticism at home, I searched for airplane information in nearby stores. Evidently, there was little public interest in aviation, for I could not find a single aviation periodical, even at the newsstands. Mother, an avid reader, suggested I visit the local branch of the Detroit Library, which turned out to be a treasure trove of information. The library services were free, a boon to my limited financial resources. The periodical section displayed current aviation magazines for in-library reading and maintained a reservoir of old issues. The aircraft book section provided a source of material for every aspect of aviation, from preliminary aircraft design to engine maintenance and flight instruction. It wasn't long before I had checked out every aviation book and magazine in their collection, many of them several times. As my knowledge grew, so did my enthusiasm. Every time an airplane flew overhead, I raced outside to watch until it was out of sight. During school hours, teachers took a dim view of my skygazing at passing airplanes, when I should have been concentrating on my studies. After hours of staring at the sky whenever airplanes flew over, I was able to distinguish the staccato bark of the fast pursuit planes based at nearby Selfridge Field from the smooth, throaty roar of the Ford tri-motors being flown from the factory located in Dearborn, a suburb of Detroit. Mother marveled at my ability to identify airplanes by the sound of their engines without even looking up. However, there still remained little family support for my aviation activities. Their negative thinking was based on newspaper reports reflecting the dangers in aviation, as well as their belief that no significant career opportunities in aviation existed for blacks. Father told me many times to stop playing with model airplanes and learn something at which I could earn a living. Also, among many blacks, there was still the feeling that we should stay in our place, and that place certainly didn't include aviation. There was even peer pressure from some of my family and friends who felt, since they were restricted to menial jobs, that I shouldn't try to be better than they were. Despite the negative climate, my enthusiasm increased every day as I built more model airplanes and read more magazines. My first career ambition was to be a smartly uniformed military aviator and fly one of the speedy, nimble Curtis Hawk pursuit planes I frequently saw darting about the Detroit skies. When one of my school teachers said I could obtain an application for the U.S. Air Corps from any U.S. post office, I quickly went to the nearest one and obtained a copy. On arriving home, I went straight to my bedroom to read the requirements in privacy, knowing my family would laugh and taunt me for dreaming such an impossible dream. One line on the application told me they were very right. It clearly stated that the applicant had to be a white male citizen. But with my unbounded enthusiasm at the age of 11, the facts of life were not all that important. I threw the application blank away and continued to dream impossible dreams. On May 20th, 1927, Charles A. Lindbergh took off from Long Island, New York, on his epic nonstop flight to Paris, creating new public interest in aviation. Any doubts I had about the seriousness of my interest were removed by that spectacular event. Airplane magazines became plentiful at all the newsstands and drugstores. Model airplane kits and supplies were available at specialty shops and major department stores, all taking advantage of the Lindbergh era. Every major newspaper had aviation cartoon strips, one of which included my favorite, Tailspin Tommy. I even stopped going to the Saturday movies with my brothers, saving what little money I could earn to buy magazines and model airplane material. At that time, I had the nightly job of cleaning up the little restaurant my mother operated in the back of our home for Pullman porters from the nearby Michigan Central Railroad station, who were laying over in Detroit for the night. I was paid 75 cents a week for my services. I gave up all my usual spending activities, including my daily 5-cent school lunch, to pay for aviation magazines and model airplane material. I was understandably a skinny kid. My first major model airplane building project was a 24-inch flying scale model of the Curtis Hawk P-1B. The airplane based at Selfridge Field, I had dreamed of flying as a military aviator. In my eyes, it was the most beautiful airplane in the world, with its red starred, bright orange wings and olive drab fuselage. One look at a completed model of the Hawk in the model airplane shop created an instant desire to have one. The cost of the kit was $3, a tremendous amount of money in those days. Saving every penny of my 75 cents a week wage, it took a month to earn the required $3. After opening the box and reading the instructions, I was ready and eager to start work on my very own model Curtis Hawk. The only table in our house big enough for this project was in the kitchen. Mother said it was mine to use each day, provided I clear it off in time for the family meal. I worked several weeks to complete the fuselage, landing gear, and tail, teaching myself the necessary skills as I made mistakes along the way. One evening, as I started to assemble the wings, Mother asked me to clear the table for supper. Putting the fuselage and other completed parts on a kitchen chair, I started to remove the wing assembly from the table. At that moment, my 9-year-old sister, Ardine, dashed into the house and without looking sat down on my model, crushing it flat. 1 month's wage and many weeks of concentrated effort was reduced to matchsticks. My typically boyish low regard for little sisters dropped to a new low. But in retrospect, that first disaster was good training for the many challenges that were to follow. A major aviation event of the late 1920s was the Ford Reliability Tour, sponsored by the Stout Metal Airplane Company, a division of the Ford Company. Ford was engaged in building one of the leading transports of the day, the all-metal Ford Trimotor. The general public still had little faith in the airplane as a safe and reliable means of transportation. Daredevil barnstorming pilots deliberately exaggerated the dangers of flight to enhance their reputation and hence earn more money. To bolster public confidence, the Ford Motor Company sponsored the Ford Annual National Air Tour to demonstrate the dependability and performance of all types of aircraft, from open cockpit three-seater biplanes to huge 10-passenger monoplane transports. The 1928 tour originated at Ford Airport in Dearborn on June 30th. 24 airplanes started the 6,000-mile tour, which stopped at 32 cities and 15 states, ending at Dearborn on July 28th. The planes were judged on performance and reliability. It may be more than simple coincidence that the Ford Tri-Motor won the last three air tours, taking permanent possession of the Ford Trophy. Waco biplanes had won the two previous tours, resulting in rule changes that evidently favored large passenger-carrying monoplanes, such as the Ford Tri-Motor. Due to the size of the event, special bus service was available from downtown Detroit. Until that time, I was unable to visit any of the local airports because they were located miles from public bus and streetcar routes. So I saved my money to ride the airport bus to my special heaven of the day, Ford Airport. The sounds of revving airplane motors, the smell of engine exhaust and doped fabric, airplanes taking off and landing at frequent intervals all conveyed a sense of excitement that I still cannot adequately describe. Airplanes of all types, large and small, went through their flight trials. I stayed all day without lunch, a black kid alone in a milling crowd, but I certainly was not lonesome. In addition to the hustle and bustle of the airplane activities, another prestigious event was scheduled, the Gordon Bennett International Balloon Race. Those manned hydrogen-filled balloons were a quiet contrast to the noisy tour aircraft. I watched with enthusiasm as teams from the United States and Europe took off in their respective colorful balloons in an effort to win the Gordon Bennett Trophy for their country. Despite my personal disappointment with the application form for the Army Air Corps, I was pleased to hear it won possession of the trophy that year. The real highlight of the day for me was watching a brand new Ford Tri-Motor as it rolled out of the comparatively dark recesses of the factory hangar onto the bright sunshine of the ramp. Shiny aluminum wings and fuselage reflected the sun's rays like a giant, multifaceted jewel. Three 200-horsepower Wright J5 whirlwind engines, just like the one on Lindbergh's Spirit of St. Louis, turned the Hamilton Standard steel propellers into mirror-like discs with a powerful roar. But then a troubling thought came to my mind. As I looked at this magnificent technical masterpiece, it occurred to me, at the age of 12, that this was the perfect airplane and therefore could not be improved upon. After all, it carried 10 people in cabin comfort at the terrific speed of 95 miles per hour. My father insisted 35 miles per hour and his Maxwell was fast enough for anybody. Each passenger sat in a wicker seat by a window, and in addition to cabin heat, the plane even had a lavatory. I had no doubt that the ultimate airplane had already been built. Hence, there was no need for future airplane engineers. My budding career as an airplane designer seemed hopeless. But again, my boundless enthusiasm and eternal optimism returned undiminished. And I went home, eager to read about that day's events in the daily newspapers. Already looking forward to buying airplane magazines reporting on the tour in technical detail. My father was not only pessimistic about my aviation career opportunities, but he also had little confidence in my mental and physical capabilities. His argument, repeated many times, was, "Neil, if skilled aviators are getting killed almost every day, how can you expect to survive with your ordinary talent?" This certainly was a rational argument, which I fully understood, but just the thought of flying in an airplane, which I had not yet experienced, outweighed whatever personal risks I might encounter. One day my father, who was in charge of the Pullman quarters at the time, met a porter, Smitty Smith from Cincinnati. Smitty had a part-time job at Lunkin Airport in Cincinnati as an aeroporter, carrying luggage to and from visiting aircraft. This placed him in close proximity to airplanes and gave him the frequent opportunity to meet skilled pilots. I was green with envy. My father took this opportunity to test my knowledge by having Smitty ask me a few questions about aviation. I answered Smitty's query about the use of radio beams for navigation quite readily. His question about aircraft engine starting procedures was also quickly answered. This is one of the few moments Father actually showed pride in my aviation knowledge. This elevated status with my father didn't last long. One of the more complex tasks associated with building a model airplane was carving the propeller. Each propeller had to be carved from a solid block of balsa, about 1 inch square and 6 to 8 inches long. I bought a supply of blocks from the nearest model airplane store and started carving with a razor blade, in my usual self-teaching mode. Father watched in silence as the pile of shavings on the floor increased steadily in size. After many attempts that day, my last one was completed with one blade going backward. I heard a soft but very sarcastic, "I told you so," laugh from my father. I redoubled my efforts the next day and was soon carving serviceable props for my models. That laugh, I am sure, drove me on to success. While Mother was not at all enthusiastic about my aviation interest, she considered it dangerous. She provided what little encouragement I received from my family. On Christmas Day, 1928, she gave me a copy of Charles Lindbergh's autobiography, We, and an imitation leather helmet complete with goggles. There wasn't a happier 12-year-old boy in the neighborhood that day. I have long since lost the helmet and goggles, but I still cherish my copy of We. Another major aviation event of the year was the second annual All-American Air Show, held April 6th through 14th, 1929, at Convention Hall in downtown Detroit. Streetcar fare was only 6 cents, so transportation was not a problem. It was a big show with over 70 airplanes on display and many smaller exhibits of aviation interest. Arriving in the morning as the show opened, I could not have been happier had I been entering the gates of heaven. The sounds, colors, and exotic smells overwhelmed my senses. Graceful, curved wings of monoplanes and biplanes blended with sleek fuselages in a brilliant panorama of color. Shiny steel propellers stood out in sharp contrast to the black engine cylinders and cowling. One airplane that caught my eye was a Balaka cabin monoplane, custom finished and painted for a reigning movie star of the day, beautiful Ann Harding. It was painted two-tone green with cream striping to complement her blonde hair and green eyes. Just to be near these beautiful creations, not Ann Harding, was a dream come true. As I walked up and down the rows of display aircraft, it became clear to me that a 13-year-old black kid in clean but shabby clothes wasn't considered a likely prospect by airplane salesmen. Ignoring me, they handed out colorful and informative brochures, many of which were discarded by often disinterested airshow attendees. I followed right behind them, picking up their discarded brochures from the floor before they were stepped on. One airplane in particular became my favorite, the Doyle Oriole. Painted in authentic oil colors of yellow and black. It was a high-wing, two-place, open-cockpit sport monoplane, in contrast to the more common biplanes of the day, with exceptionally smooth, graceful lines. I stood by this exhibit for at least an hour before someone finally threw away a Doyle brochure, which I quickly added to my collection. In the weeks following the show, I carefully examined my colorful brochures, especially my favorite, the Doyle. Also among my treasure of brochures were those for the Wacos, Stinsons, Ryans, Balancas, Fokkers, and Fords I had carefully inspected during the show. I spent much of my spare time at home fantasizing about the wonderful and exciting flights I would make someday in these marvelous machines. As my model airplane skills increased, I built detailed flying scale models of those same airplanes, adding a touch of reality to my fantasies of flight. Another touch of reality was not so obvious to me in December 1928. I had already experienced the realities of racial discrimination in reading the cadet application for the U.S. Air Corps. However, discriminatory attitudes in commercial aviation were much more subtle. The exclusion of blacks from all aspects of aviation, including white flying schools, even when the applicant had sufficient funds, was not advertised, but no less rigidly practiced. The low regard for the intelligence and moral character of Negroes was evident in a joke printed in the aviation humor section of the December 1928 edition of Aero Digest. This magazine was the leading aviation periodical of that era, and by referring to blacks only in a derogatory manner, typified the prevailing negative racial attitudes, even at highly respectable levels of aviation. The humor page was entitled, Picked from the Air. Colored man to pilot. Say, boss, give me one of them $3 hops. Just before taking off, the colored man signals to the pilot, Roll it just a little bit so I can get that drunken sensation. Pilot, how much rolling you want?
Colored man, use your own judgment. You know $3 will buy a lot of gin.
I was only 12 years old at the time when I read this so-called humor, and was blissfully unaware of its implications. However, I soon learned the whites-only practices in commercial aviation were no less rigid than those of the U.S. Air Corps. But true dreams are not confined by reality, so I continued to look to the bright blue sky for my future. Most memorable in 1929 was the official opening of Detroit City Airport, located at Gratiot and Connor Avenues, well within the city limits of Detroit. The Gratiot streetcar line went right by the airport, and the fare was still only 6 cents. This was the first airport I could reach by regularly scheduled public transportation. French Road ran parallel to the north-south runway across the middle of the frequently used east-west runway. A policeman from the nearby Connor station patrolled the airport in his yellow Model A Ford Roadster. Stopping the auto traffic is necessary to prevent auto-slash-airplane collisions. The only hangar on the field was operated by the 107th Army Observation Squadron of the Michigan National Guard. During my many visits, the mechanics never spoke to me, but did not seem to mind as I quietly watched them perform their maintenance duties. For their peace of mind, I kept my hands in my pockets and never interfered with their work. Occasionally, I was especially rewarded when the flight crews took off in their Liberty-powered Douglas 02H observation biplanes on routine missions. The National Guard personnel must have become comfortable with my presence, for I was there as often as I could afford the streetcar fare, and no one questioned me. The fall of 1929 was the beginning of my last year at Franklin Elementary School, 8th grade. Due to our family circumstances, poverty, welfare, evictions, I had attended 7 elementary schools prior to entering Franklin. But I managed to maintain a good scholastic record and was given the privilege of being a hall monitor to check students in the hallway between classes to make sure they had an authorized pass. Since there was very little student traffic, I started writing poetry to pass the time. My level of interest increased when my English teacher announced a poetry contest with an unidentified first prize. With this as inducement, I wrote a poem titled, My Ambition. It was several verses long and ended with these lines. If my dreams for the future prevail, I shall be flying your Daily Mail. There must have been very little competition, for I won first prize, which I learned later was the unwanted honor of reciting my poem at the 8th grade graduation ceremonies in January 1930. And even worse,
My poetry efforts were to cause me serious problems when I entered Jefferson Intermediate School the following month. Miss MacDonald was a very refined and cultured English teacher at Jefferson. She had dark, wavy red hair and always dressed in quite good taste. I was very much impressed by her professional appearance and was proud to be in her class. Miss MacDonald was also editor of the school paper and occasionally invited members of her class to submit original material for possible publication. With confidence resulting from my winning the 8th grade poetry competition at Franklin School, I submitted several of my poems for consideration. A few days later, on entering my English class, it was obvious Miss MacDonald was upset. As soon as the door was shut, she told us to close our books and announced she was going to read some literary material that had been submitted for publication in a school paper. No names would be mentioned, since she wanted us to make an unbiased judgment as to whether or not a student in her class could write with such adult skills. It was clear she thought the work was plagiarized. Until then, I thought I was an innocent bystander. But when she started to read one of my poems, I knew I was in deep trouble. It didn't help knowing I was the only black kid in the class. When Miss MacDonald finished reading the poem, she asked the class to vote on the matter. Several of my classmates from Franklin School were in the class and recognized the poem as mine. When they expressed their belief that I had written it, she became infuriated and ordered me to leave the class and report immediately to the principal's office. In his private study, the principal told me attempted plagiarism was a very serious matter. After my denial, he offered me an opportunity to prove my skills by allowing me the use of his walnut-paneled study, plus paper and pencil, so I could write an original literary work. As he closed the door, I sat down in his chair in a state of panic. Staring blankly at the paper, I was totally incapable of creative thought. When he returned an hour later, my paper was blank. After inquiring of my family background and finding no evidence of literary skills, the principal was assured of my guilt. He decided not to allow me to return to school until Mother came on my behalf. Although I was sure she had not convinced him of my innocence, I was finally allowed to resume my English studies. Miss MacDonald refused to let me back into her class, however, and never spoke to me again. Years later, when free of raising children, Mother took an interest in creative writing and began a successful career as author, playwright, and publisher. In retrospect, I've often wondered how a trained educator could give a 14-year-old boy pencil and paper, put him in an unfamiliar room under stressful conditions, and allow him an hour to create high-quality literature. It brought an end to my interest in writing poetry. The one bright note during my 1 year at Jefferson Intermediate School was being elected president of the newly formed Jefferson Aeronautics Club, even though I was the only black member. My election was probably by default, since none of the student members had been studying aviation as long as I had, and Mr. Merkobrad, our advisor and machine shop instructor, had very little aeronautical knowledge. During my term of office, I acted both as president and instructor. It was good experience for me since in the process of teaching, I studied constantly and learned much more than I taught. It was also the first time I was able to share my interest in aviation with boys my own age. One of my new friends was a chubby boy named Bob Summerfield. Both of us dreamed of owning an airplane, but we realized our age and limited financial resources made it impossible. After much discussion, we made a deal. I would design a ground trainer type airplane, and he would provide the funds for its construction. We took in another partner, Lester Leroux, who was to help with the construction. I completed my first design, based on a Curtis Hawk, of course, to be powered by a one-cylinder air compressor that I planned to convert to a two-cycle gasoline engine. After looking at my plans, Bob immediately lost interest when he realized he was too big to get into the cockpit. The project was canceled by mutual agreement, but we remained friends, and I would see Bob and Lester again when I entered high school. May 5th, 1930, is a date I remember as well as my birthday. I had saved up $5 for my first airplane ride at Detroit City Airport. There, parked on the ramp on this warm spring day, was an OX-5-powered Waco NC-4045, an open-cockpit biplane, its yellow wings and green fuselage shining in the bright sunlight. The pilot, who was also the salesman, said the ride would cost only $3, with $2 remaining from my $5 bill plus another $1 I could raise during the week. I was already planning to come back the next Sunday for a second ride, even before I had my first. While these thoughts raced through my mind, the pilot waited for another passenger to fill the other available front seat. The longer I waited for my long-sought flight, the more my youthful courage diminished. Overcome by fear, I finally went back to the pilot and asked him to return my money, but he refused. Realizing how scared I was, and with no other prospective customer in sight, he decided at long last to give me my ride. I climbed in a two-seated front cockpit and nervously strapped myself in. The engine started with a mighty roar, and the airplane vibrated in response to the whirling prop. I began to shake with fright. While we taxied to the north end of the field along French Road, I noticed a young white boy about my age standing on the sidewalk signaling vigorously his desire to go flying. From the back cockpit, the pilot shouted, "Is it all right with you if the boy comes along?" As frightened as I was happy to have company, even if he was a non-paying passenger. We shook hands when he got in, and with mutual courage looked forward to the takeoff, even as we bounced along on the uneven turf. Once on a concrete runway, with the throttle open wide, we moved swiftly and seconds later were in indescribably smooth flight. As the ground dropped away, the panoramic vista of the earth viewed through the wire-braced wings of our Waco filled our eyes with such delights that all our fears were forgotten. We flew over downtown Detroit, looking down on the skyscrapers, including the 40-story Penobscot building, which looked like a small matchbox. Then we flew up the Detroit River in the afternoon haze to Belle Isle, a popular city park. My new friend and I were ecstatic and hoped this moment would last forever. However, as we turned north, we could see Detroit City Airport, followed much too soon by a smooth landing on runway 15. The flight probably lasted only about 15 minutes, but it was an unforgettable experience that lives in my mind to this day. Certainly, my family thought I would never stop talking about it. Plans to save my remaining $2 toward another airplane ride were dashed the following week. In my excitement, I had not remembered that my brother Robert's birthday was on May 7th, my father's on May 9th, followed by my mother's on May 14th. Ensuing purchases for birthday gifts eliminated my airplane ride fund. Several months later, I was able to save enough money to take mother for an airplane ride. She was the only family member amenable to the idea. This time, I arranged a flight in a four-passenger cabin, Stinson monoplane. I sat next to the pilot in a co-pilot seat, while Mother sat alone in luxury behind us. I was surprised how much she seemed to enjoy the experience after we were airborne. The look of wonder on her face as she watched the roads and houses diminish to toy-like sizes pleased me. Her face almost touched the window glass as she remarked how the green lawns of Belle Isle Park looked like a well-kept carpet. The flight was going so well, the pilot turned to face Mother so he could point out landmarks of interest. With considerable experience as a backseat driver riding behind her teenage sons, she told him quite sternly, "Young man, please turn around and keep your eyes on the road." He meekly followed orders and went back to the routine business of flying. My admiration for Mother increased immeasurably for her having the courage to go with me on that flight. We now had a common bond of flight experience that we alone could share. Somehow, I no longer felt so lonely in my world of aviation. Chapter 2. Designs. When I entered Cass Technical High School in January 1931, the United States and many other nations of the world were in the grip of the Great Depression. As with millions of other families at that time, the Loving family's financial situation had reached a new low. Father had given up his practice of optometry, but managed to eke out an existence by getting odd jobs using his skills in plumbing and carpentry. His income was sporadic, however, and we were forced to move quite often, sometimes even by eviction. Occasionally, we moved to my maternal grandmother's house, where the relationship between my father and my grandmother was so strained, they would not speak to each other, resulting in emotional stress in the Loving family, especially among the children. When we could not afford the price of a bushel of coal during cold weather, our water pipes would freeze, making our toilet unusable. By 1931, our circumstances were so desperate, my mother applied for welfare assistance from the city. My father was too proud to do so himself. It was at this time, when my family was practically destitute, that I entered high school. Cass Technical High School was and is a large facility, one city block long with 7 full floors, located near downtown Detroit. The curricula offerings were equally impressive, with courses ranging from music, electrical theory and practice, and costume design to pre-nursing. I entered the auto/aero department, where naturally I chose to specialize in aeronautics. The two aeronautics courses, aircraft mechanics and aircraft engines, were offered in a senior year only. Cass Tech's school brochure emphasized that it was not a vocational school, and all courses were college preparatory. On entering Cass Tech, I was overwhelmed by its physical size and the thousands of students moving randomly in the hallways on their way to class. This was quite a change from the regimented elementary school, where students were required to walk in single file under strict supervision from class to class. In elementary school, no student was allowed in a hallway during school hours unless he or she had a pass issued by a teacher. At Cass Tech, the faculty expected the students to act responsibly without strict adult surveillance. The first problem I faced was financial. Up to the 9th grade, all books were provided to the students free of charge by the Detroit Board of Education. At the high school level, however, students were required to buy their assigned textbooks at the school bookstore. I managed to earn enough money to buy the paper supplies, but books were financially out of the question. I partially resolved the problem by borrowing books from my Jefferson school friends, Bob Summerfield and Lester LaRoe. They were happy to accommodate me since I promised to complete their homework assignments before I did my own. Lack of school books would cause me many problems, but in one instance, it was a blessing. One day, my freshman English teacher gave our class an assignment to read a famous French poem, The Prisoner of Chalon. I could not borrow a book, and the next day was totally unprepared for class. On entering the room, we were told to close our books and write a review of the poem. Knowing only the title and the time period in which it was written, I used my imagination to its fullest to write my review. I discussed at length the terrible condition of the French prisons and the political problems of the Napoleonic era. At the next class session, the teacher went over some of the reviews and expressed her special satisfaction with one. What made her particularly happy with this particular review was that it expressed original thoughts and did not parrot words directly from the poem. I was surprised and pleased that it was my work she was praising, for which I received an A+. Since I had not read the poem, how could I not be original? This is one of the few cases where I could say ignorance is bliss. Another memorable event for me in high school occurred about 2 weeks after I enrolled in the auto/aero department. The department head, A.D. Althaus, sent a note through my homeroom teacher asking me to see him in his office. Such a summons usually indicated serious trouble, but I could not think of what I might have done to warrant this request. Trying to keep my fears under control, I went to his office at the appointed time. He was very pleasant and said that his only reason for wanting to see me was that he had just been informed there was a black student in the aero department. In his official capacity as my advisor, he wanted me to know there were no employment opportunities for me in aviation. He suggested I transfer to the auto department where my skills could be used to make a living among my own people. Undeterred, I asked if I could remain in the aero department. He gave his permission without much enthusiasm, but I left his office with a sense of relief and happiness. Not only was I not in trouble, but I could stay and graduate the aeronautical knowledge and experience I had come to Cass Tech to obtain. Meeting William Bill Maddock early in my freshman year began a friendship that I cherish to this day. He was a white teenager from a relatively affluent family. In spite of our widely different backgrounds, he became a warm, caring friend. We shared a deep and passionate love for aviation at a level well above that of our classmates. I was especially impressed by Bill's background, since he had already soloed and was practicing for his private pilot rating. In one of our many conversations, he offered to sponsor my membership in the Cass Aero Club, of which he was already a member. With the pleasant memories of the Jefferson Aeronautics Club still fresh in my mind, I agreed to apply for membership. At the next meeting of the Aero Club, Bill submitted my name, much to his surprise, not mine. My application was rejected. Upon asking the club advisor for a reason, he was told that blacks were not eligible for membership. I think this action hurt his feelings far more than mine, for this kind of racism was common in my life. A few weeks later, Bill made the headlines of the Detroit newspapers when he failed to recover from an unintentional tailspin in a fleet biplane. He was killed instantly in the ensuing crash near Detroit City Airport. For the first time, the realities of the dangers involved in flying were brought home to me. But my enthusiasm was not diminished in any way. I was both surprised and pleased when I saw the school yearbook published at my graduation in 1934. It included a picture of Bill, even though he had been dead for almost 2 years. I still have that yearbook. The high point of my high school career was the aircraft mechanics course taught by George Taberham. He was a World War I veteran, a skilled mechanic, and an experienced pilot. He was also a no-nonsense teacher who demanded mature behavior in class and set student performance standards that met the requirements for a government aircraft mechanic. This was my first opportunity to actually work on real airplanes, and I was as happy as during my first airplane ride. The smell of aircraft dope, applied to tighten and waterproof the fabric covering of wings and fuselages, was like perfume. On one occasion, however, I created a serious problem because I didn't smell the dope before application. Mr. Taberham was unable to teach class for a few days, and a substitute, Mr. Fisher, a chemistry teacher, took his place. Knowing nothing at all about aircraft mechanics, he allowed the students to continue their projects on their own. However, when technical decisions had to be made, I was surprised when he came to me for help. On Mr. Fisher's second day as teacher, when one of the students came asking for dope thinner, he referred him to me. I went into the supply room and found a 5-gallon can labeled Aircraft Dope Thinner. I shook the can vigorously to make sure its viscosity was that of thinner and not the more viscous dope, and gave it to him to use. He came to me later and said the thinner didn't seem right when he mixed it with the dope. After applying several coats to the wing, he expressed concern that it did not produce the normal glossy sheen. After looking at it, I decided that high humidity was causing the dope to blush, so I advised him to continue the application. I thought it was a minor problem, that could be cured by applying a coat of pure thinner on a less humid day. When Mr. Taberham returned the next day, I was sitting in a cockpit of an airplane installing an instrument. All of a sudden, I heard him shouting loudly in uncharacteristic language. Clearly, he was madder than hell. Finally, he came over and told me the problem. "Some lame brain in this class," he confided, "has used aircraft gasoline instead of thinner, which has ruined the covering on a complete set of wings." Knowing I was that lame brain, and being immobilized in the cockpit, I tried desperately to figure a safe way out of my dilemma. Realizing how angry he was, I was terrified at the thought of punishment. In a state of panic, I couldn't think of a reasonable excuse for my mistake, so I confessed. He stared at me, his face almost livid with anger. Then he burst out laughing. He explained how he had marked 3 X's on the thinner can with white chalk to identify it as gasoline, but only he knew of it. He did note, however, that if I had smelled the can, I would have known it was gasoline, not thinner. Admitting it was partially his error, he never mentioned it again. On his last day of class, Mr. Fisher asked me to meet him in the parking lot at the end of the school day. When I met him there, he invited me into his car and drove to his home. His teenage nephew had just moved out, leaving a supply of clothing which, fortunately for me, was my size. Mr. Fisher invited me to take whatever I wanted. I picked a beautiful dark Oxford gray suit complete with matching accessories, including shirt and tie. Mr. Fisher then gave me car fare to get home. It was an act of generosity and thoughtfulness from a gentleman I would never see again. Kohler Airlines initiated airline passenger service between the waterfront cities of Milwaukee, Detroit, and Cleveland, using 6-passenger loaning amphibians that took off from downtown waterfront areas, eliminating long car trips to the airport. The passenger facility was set up near the Ambassador Bridge, a short distance west of downtown Detroit. Fortunately for me, it was within walking distance of my house and I was a frequent visitor. The red and black loanings made an impressive sight as they taxied out in a cloud of spray and took off to the thunder of their 575 horsepower Wright Cyclone engines. I built a 3-foot exact scale model of the loaning, fitted it with 6 miniature seats, and painted it in Kohler airline colors. It represented months of work and several valuable dollars in materials. In a moment of financial desperation, I placed it on sale at a variety store on busy Michigan Avenue, hoping it would bring a good price as promised by the store owner. I was crestfallen when he told me he had sold it for $5 and gave me $3 for my efforts. I was sure he had sold it for more than $5, so I made up my mind to increase my knowledge of the business world as well as aviation. During the fall of 1932, my father, with the encouragement and support of the Detroit Welfare Department, opened an office of optometry catering especially to welfare patients. Again, his practice was unsuccessful due to insufficient clientele. But during the time his office was open, a young, eager black salesman, Don Pearl Simmons, came by selling airplane brand sausage. Intrigued by the name of the sausage, my father asked for additional information. Don told him he was president of the Ace Flying Club, an all-black organization devoted to teaching blacks to fly. The money raised by selling the sausage was to be used to help buy an airplane for that purpose. My father immediately told him of my interest in aviation and suggested that I be invited to join. I received the invitation from Don by phone the next day. The first meeting of the Ace Flying Club I attended was in February 1933, in an abandoned storefront on Davidson Avenue in Northeast Detroit. Shortly after my arrival, a member came in who attracted the attention of all the males present. Ursley Taylor, the club secretary, a tall and slender young woman, with gray eyes and reddish blonde hair, was quiet, modest, and soft-spoken. Her devotion to aviation was on par with mine. It was the beginning of a lifelong friendship and shared aviation careers. At this meeting, I learned the club had purchased an Ox 5-powered Alexander Eagle Rock biplane that was complete in every respect except for the wings. An experimental set of wings had been purchased which were quite different from those originally installed on the Eagle Rock. Therefore, considerable design and modification work were required before the airplane would be ready for flight. Since I was in Mr. Taberham's aircraft mechanics course at the time, it was decided I should be in charge of the modification project. Knowing I could rely on Mr. Taberham for whatever technical support I needed, I accepted this adult responsibility at the tender age of 17. I went to the large garage where the airplane was located, taking detailed measurements necessary for the wing modifications. I took these data to Mr. Taberham for his analysis and design recommendations. Since this would be a lengthy process, I recommended that club members start building the upper wing center section before starting other projects in planned sequence. During this time, the rusted wing fittings were to be either repaired or replaced. Although the garage was unheated and the weather chilly in March, the Eagle Rock conversion project started with enthusiasm. With our common aviation interests, Ursley and I became an inseparable team. Our lack of finances also was mutual. Usually we had only enough money for streetcar fare. One morning we had worked quite hard up to lunch hour and began to feel the pangs of hunger. We pulled our financial resources and found, after streetcar fare, we had 5 pennies between us. After much serious thought, we decided to buy a nickel package of cheese tidbits instead of a candy bar. These were small, very salty cheese-flavored crackers. We figured the salt would make us so thirsty that we would be glad to drink a lot of water, which would help fill our stomachs. This scheme took care of our thirst and hunger pains, too. During the spring months, I continued to supervise the airplane rebuilding project, as well as work on some of the parts at Cash Tech with Mr. Taberham's permission. In mid-May, a severe throat infection kept me out of school for several weeks. During my absence, Ursley proceeded with the project, and after a few days came to my house with disturbing news. It seemed Don Simmons had obtained a contract to use the club airplane for advertising purposes in early June. To meet this deadline, he had to ignore many of the time-consuming procedures I had recommended to make the plane airworthy. At Ursley's suggestion, I went out to look at the airplane even though my doctor said I wasn't supposed to leave home. I made sure that most of the members were present, including Don Simmons, at the time of my visit. I was appalled by the poor quality workmanship and the engineering shortcuts that were being taken to save time. Rusty fittings that should have been replaced were sanded and painted for reuse, instead of making a completely new set of wing/fuselage attachment fittings. The group used the existing Eagle Rock fittings. This placed the airplane's center of gravity well beyond safe limits, which was certain to cause serious control problems. I concluded the airplane was definitely unairworthy. This portion of the work was being supervised by a member whose sole aviation education consisted of a short correspondence school course, but he was so confident he offered to financially guarantee his work. Don asked if I was willing to do likewise. My reply was yes, if the work was completed to proper airworthiness standards and an accomplished pilot hired to do the test flying. Don decided this would take too much time and money, so my offer was rejected. I left the shop immediately without further discussion, but I still had serious doubts about the success of the airplane rebuilding project. Little did I realize the magnitude of the disaster that was to follow. 2 weeks later, while still convalescing, I went downstairs to pick up my grandmother's Detroit Free Press, which I liked to read while eating breakfast. On unfolding the paper, I saw the front page headline in bold black letters. Local pilot and wife killed in airplane accident. Without further reading, I knew it was Don Simmons and his wife, Kathleen. The newspaper story was so technically garbled, however, that I had to call Ursley for an accurate account of what happened. Don and other club members had taken the airplane out to Burns Airport on the west side of Detroit for final assembly. The airport manager took one look at the assembled airplane and immediately declared it unairworthy. He not only ordered Don to cancel any test flight plans, but to remove the airplane from the airport as soon as possible. Don waited until the manager went home for supper and then rolled the plane out for takeoff. This was to be not only the first flight for the airplane, but Don's first solo flight as well. This was both an illegal and foolishly immature decision. He managed to get it off the ground successfully, and after a short flight landed safely at the airport. The club member who had supervised the work climbed in the passenger cockpit for the second flight, in total violation of all government regulations and common sense. Don's wife, Kathleen, objected, saying Don promised she would be the first passenger. Don acquiesced, and she climbed in to replace the club member. On this second flight, with the extra weight of Kathleen making the airplane nose-heavy, Don was unable to clear the telephone wires at the end of the field. The landing gear struck the wires, rolling the airplane upside down and pulling the adjacent telephone poles directly across the cockpit. Don was killed immediately. His wife died 2 hours later.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.